Now we know how to name organic molecules, and what we're going to do next is figure out how do we go from a name to the drawing of a molecule. So we're going to start with names that sound very complex, but find out that it's actually not that difficult to put them together. Let's start with something relatively simple. We'll start with 2-methylbutane. And what we want to do is we want to draw a skeletal structure for 2-methylbutane. The easiest thing to do is to draw your backbone first and then add substituents. The name tells you where to add them and how many to add. So 2-methylbutane, we're going to draw our backbone first. Hopefully you remember that butane is 4, so butane is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, and then that 2. Which carbon's number 2? Do we go from the left, do we go from the right? It doesn't matter. When we're creating the molecule, left and right make no difference. So I usually start from the left, so this will be 1, 2, 3, and 4. And so I'm going to put a methyl onto 2-methylbutane. Now it's really important that whenever you're doing these structures that you add the substituent on. You don't change anything. You don't change something that you already drew. You always add. So I'm going to add on a methyl right there. Remember, this unlabeled part right here is a CH3. And so I've added a methyl, and this is 2-methylbutane. Our next example that we're going to do is 3-isopropyl pentane. And again, we draw the backbone first. Pentane is 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Number 3, 1, 2, and 3. And we put an isopropyl on there. And if you remember isopropyl, propyl is 3. So we've got 3 carbons, and an iso means connected in the middle. So don't do this. That's not 3. Just because I kind of wrote my things a little bit, I'm going to attach something with 3 carbons. 1, 2, 3 carbons. It's always good to double check that what you're attaching is what you think you attached. It's really easy to start drawing lines and not draw enough lines or things like that. So that is 3-isopropyl pentane. Our next example is going to be 1,2-dibromo, 3-ethyl hexane. And you know, before you watch these videos, if I put that in front of you, you might have panicked and said, well, I don't understand what 1,2-dibromo, 3-ethyl hexane is. But that's actually not that hard. You start with the backbone of hexane. Hex is 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then we're going to put a bromo on 1 and 2. Now, what I'm going to do first is I'm going to do it wrong first. So don't look at what I'm doing and think, hey, this is the way to do it. Very tempting. People say 1,2-dibromo. Let me just put a bromo on 1, and they put the BR there. But what did I just do? When I didn't have the BR there, what is this? That's a carbon, which means we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons in total. But if I put the bromine there, I've now changed that into not a carbon, and I don't have 6 carbons anymore. I only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. So you have to be really careful when you're adding especially halogens onto a backbone that you add them on. And when you add them on, one thing I do sometimes just to remind myself is do them in a different color. So I add on bromine in a different color. And then I need bromine on number 2 as well. I add on bromine in a different color. And then on 3, I add ethyl. And if you remember what ethyl is, it's F2. And so I'm going to say 1 carbon and 2 carbons, right? 1 carbon and 2 carbons. It's a little bit different when we're adding substituents, how we count. We don't count when we put our pen down. We count when we move, because there's already a carbon where we put our pen down. And this is 1,2-dibromo, 3-ethyl hexane. Our next example is going to be 2,2,3-trimethylheptane. And if you remember, hept is 7. So we're going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 2, comma 2, comma 3. Again, I'm going to do it wrong first and then show you the right way. People say, well, if this is 1 and this is 2, then I'm going to add a methyl here and a methyl here. But if you look back at our little structures that we have like this, we've got our almost our up, down, up, down. There we go. And if you look at this right here, so a bridge right there, there's never room anything inside this V for anything to go in there. There's not room there. Both things on the tetrahedron go on the outside of the V that we see here. So we've got these two hydrogens here on the outside of the V. And the same thing is going to happen when you're drawing these skeletal structures. I'm not going to put one on the inside and one on the outside. I'm going to put both on the outside like that. And so that's my 2,2-dimethyl. But I also had a methyl on 3, and so I'm going to put a methyl on 3 just like that. And now I've got 2,2,3-trimethylheptane. Our last example is going to be 1,3-dichloro, 2-ethylcyclohexane. Again, very fancy looking, very huge looking name. Like, oh, how can you possibly understand this? And by the way, after this section, when you read things like shampoo bottles, they'll make a little more sense. Draw our backbone first. Remember, in this class, the ring is the backbone. So our cyclohexane is our backbone. Hex is 6. We draw it like that. Where do we start numbering? Doesn't matter. I usually do it from the top and then clockwise, but you don't have to. But it's an easy if you just kind of pick a way of doing it and stick with it as opposed to changing each time. So 1,3-dichloro, I'm going to put a chloro on number 1. I'm going to put a chloro on number 3. I'm going to put an ethyl, which has 2 carbons, on number 2. There's 1 carbon, 2 carbons. And there is my 1,3-dichloro-2-ethylcyclohexane. So I told you at the beginning that once you get used to these and see them often enough, when you read one of these names, you can actually draw it fairly quickly. Draw the backbone, add the substituents where it tells you to. All right, thank you.